Hey, good morning, everyone. As always, it's great to be able to worship with you all, and hopefully you're all staying safe. If you're new to joining us, I'm Craig Ishihara. I'm the pastor here at Berkeley Methodist United Church, and as always, it's an honor to just join and worship together with all of you today. Got a couple announcements before we begin worship. Most of it you saw on our video, but wanted to just remind you that we are having a fundraiser where we are hoping to raise at least $8,000 towards support of the Black community during this time. And so we invite you to contribute what you can. For details, go to our website, bmuc.org/BLM, bmuc.org/BLM. Also, next week would normally be our Communion Sunday, but because of annual conference, we're going to be having a conference-wide worship service. And so wanted to just invite you all to be part of that. And I will send out a link and also put it on our Facebook page so you know exactly all the details about where to tune in and how to join us. But hopefully you'll see it. It should be a really well done worship that is really meaningful for us as we think about what it means to be the Church of Christ together. Speaking of which, World Communion Sunday is coming up. So we're going to postpone communion until World Communion Sunday, which is the first Sunday in October. And I want to invite you to join us as we share that Sunday and have communion with every church around the world. Every churches from all denominations from every country will join in, and we'll have, if not at the same time, we'll all have communion on that one Sunday as we celebrate what it means to be the Church of God together. All right, well, that's it for announcements for now. I'm going to turn it over to our worship leader this morning, Cheryl Takawapon. So Cheryl, I'm going to ask you to go ahead and open us up with prayer.
Hi, I'm Cheryl Takawapon, and you'll have to forgive me. There's a lot of noise going on in my house right now. I have like conversations and like people working on our house. So hopefully I can use my teacher voice and you guys will be able to hear me. please join me in the opening prayer. Dear Lord, this has been a little bit of a weird week. We began with what felt like very hot weather. In the middle of the week, the sky looked so different than anything I had ever seen before. And today we come together to worship you with overcast skies and cooler temperatures outside. We are reminded how fortunate we are to be living in areas that are not yet in danger of the wildfires, and or that we are able to stay indoors in the safety of our homes. But we are also reminded of those who are affected by the smoke, the air quality, and the actual fires, as well as those who are not as fortunate as we are to have homes to stay in, good health, and an abundance of food. As we worship you today, let us take a brief break from the world out there to open our minds to what you have to teach us and open our hearts to those around us and to you. May we find joy in our time together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Cheryl. We have, it's going to be fun today. We have a different kind of worship as we are, today's sermon is titled Tomorrowland. And so I challenged Naomi to do something different with music. And she has. I'm excited about what we're going to hear today. So I'm going to turn it over to Naomi, share a little bit about what we're going to hear next. Naomi?
Thanks, Reverend Craig. Good morning, everyone. We are so excited. The gals and I, Stephanie and Naomi Mascarinas, and I are excited to share some music that's more contemporary, as it were. And instead of doing completely traditional worship music, as we usually do, we have a couple of Broadway songs to share with you. And you might ask, well, you know, how does that fit into anything? And the first song that I would like to share with you is called Journey to the Past. And it comes from an animation that maybe you or your kids watched some time ago called Anastasia. And not at this time, but it actually was turned into very recently a beautiful Broadway production. And this particular song, Journey to the Past, okay, well, you're maybe thinking, Reverend Craig just said, we're going to talk about tomorrow and Tomorrowland in the future. Why is Naomi going to share a song about the past? And, you know, what really spoke to me about the song and the theme is that it's actually a song about stepping forward into the future. And while we hold really close to us, you know, and especially at this time, in some cases, it's like, you know, we haven't been near our families. We have not been with our church families. So literally as well as with our church family. And so we have this memory and we hold on to what we can. But we also, if we want to continue with our lives, with receiving the blessings, we have to take that chance and take a step forward. So this is a song about holding those memories close to us, but also being open to taking a step forward. And, you know, I know I've experienced this. I'm sure you can think of lots of times in your lives when you've just taken a leap of faith and been astonished at what that blessing brings. And that's what this song is about. So this is Journey to the Past from Anastasia.
Thanks, Naomi. I thought that was a great job. I love that song. That's one of my favorites. And Emma and I had the chance to actually see that play on Broadway. Yeah, Cassie was with us too, and loved it. That's an amazing song. We're going to enter into our time for prayers of the people. I wanted to just invite you to share the things that are most on your heart, things that perhaps you want us to lift up, whether they're praises or whether they're concerns. Help us that we can pray together to be the people of God. Definitely wanted to lift up in prayer all of those who are fighting fires and dealing with everything related to the fires and the whole situation with health and everything else going on. Lift up all the firefighters who are fighting the fires and all the healthcare workers who are having to deal with it too. So Lord, hear are our prayers. Praying for all of you. I hope you are all staying safe and that you are being healthy and staying inside. I know it's been really tough for everyone. One thing that's been on my mind a lot has been about mental health. As pastor, we've been talking about that a lot. And with the pandemic, I'm sure there are a lot of folks who are struggling with depression or anxiety. If you are, you're always welcome to reach out to me. I'm more than willing to listen and to help in whatever way I can. But I want to encourage you also, if you really feel that you're feeling extra depressed or extra anxious, to please get professional help also. That can be such a lifesaver during these times. So please don't be afraid and reach out so that we can help one another. Lord, hear are our prayers. Lois asked if we could please pray for her grandson, Evan, who's going off to boot camp. So, wow, that must be difficult during this time. So safe journeys for him and hopefully a good health and a successful boot camp. Olivia asked if we could pray for her uncle, Reuben, who passed away on Tuesday. Oh, I'm really sorry to hear about that. Pray for Mr. Sanchez, their neighbor, who also passed away. Oh my gosh. I remember we prayed about him when his wife passed away 6 months ago. And so if we can keep the rest of their family in prayer and all those who cared for him. Also prayers for Olivia's Aunt Aurora, who passed away last month. And for everyone who's having to suffer in silence during this time, Lord, hear our prayers. Pauline's giving us another update. Oh, good. Her mom and her aunts are doing well. As you know, we've been praying for them. And thankfully, they have they've all been diagnosed at one point with COVID-19, but have all made it through. So we're just grateful for that. But Pauline also asked if we could please make sure to keep the LGBTQ community in prayer, that this is Oakland Pride Week, and also pray for the homeless who are stranded outdoors with poor quality. So Cheryl, going back to what Cheryl had brought up too, not everyone is as fortunate as many of us are. If you're on Zoom, you are fortunate. So Lord, hear our prayers. Oh, wow. Liz wanted to lift up Dave Perez that last week his family was told that they would have to say their goodbyes, but he made a turn for the better and he's off his ventilator. So that's amazing. He has a challenging road ahead, but so grateful for answered prayers. So Lord, hear our prayers. And Naomi asked if we could pray for her friend Darlene, who is singing at a friend's memorial service today. Wow, sad and also scary. I hope that Darlene is safe and we'll just pray for everyone who's at that service. Lord, hear our prayers. Oh my gosh, I didn't know Paul's sister lived in Oregon. I don't know why I didn't know that. But Olivia asked if we could pray for Paul's sister who does live in Oregon, and the fire had forced her to evacuate for a couple of days. As bad as it is down here, I know that there are a lot of folks who are doing even worse. And so let's keep them in our prayers. Lord, hear our prayers. Mary asked if we could make sure to keep in prayer all those during this time of election. I probably don't have to tell you that the election's coming up and pretty fast too. There does seem to be a lot of misinformation out there, a lot of attempts to block people from expressing themselves and voting. So just keep in prayer our whole country. Pray that people who want to vote will be able to vote, that people will not be stifled in expressing their voice, and that we will let God guide us in how we vote. Lord, hear our prayers. Let's go ahead and bow our heads together and let's pray to the Lord. If you'll join me, let's pray. Gracious God Almighty, we just ask that you would continue to rain down your blessings upon us as you have. I know for some of us it might seem like, what blessings are you talking about? But the very fact that we're here worshiping together means that we are blessed people. We ask you, Lord, to help remind us of the many blessings we do have, despite the things going on in the world today. That even though there are a lot of things to be concerned about, at the same time, we just lift up praise for the many things that are going well. And so we just thank you, Lord, for the ways in which you have blessed our lives and continue to do so. We pray, Lord, for those who are in need at this time, the ones we've lifted up and that we've shared together today, but also the ones who don't have a voice for themselves, who don't perhaps have a relationship with you in the same way that they can feel open to come to you and to express their hopes and their dreams to you. But also for those who are homeless, for those who don't have access to any kind of worship right now, let alone online worship, but not able to come to a church and to join in a community together. We pray for those in our own congregation who are separated from us. And we ask you, Lord, to keep them well and help us to stay in touch with them. We pray, Lord, that at this time we are able to lift up everyone and to truly be your hands and feet in the world. We ask you, Lord, to guide us, the leadership for our churches, the leadership for our country, the leadership for our world, that you would give them strength and guidance and that they would look to right paths to make the right choices to help as many as possible. We pray for this in the name of your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever. Amen. We are fortunate to have more special music, and I'm going to let Naomi share what we're going to hear next. Naomi?
Thank you. Well, next we get to hear again from Stephanie Suzuki. And this morning she's sharing this wonderful praise song, and you might be familiar with it. I think that we've sung it at church sometimes. It's called Your Grace is Enough. And while we, you know, do our part in our faithfulness to God, our courage and faith in stepping forward, you know, the opening lyric here is, great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy, and nothing can keep us apart. And so it's a song that's a reminder that God's care and love is what carries us through, and we can rest in that. So as much as it feels like sometimes we have day-to-day struggle, we can always come back to the promise that God's grace is enough for us. So I hope you will enjoy hearing Stephanie on this beautiful song.
Great is your faithfulness, O God.
Wow, that was wonderful. I love that song. I'm going to ask Cheryl to lead us in a prayer as we enter into our time of offering. So Cheryl, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Thank you. Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for all the blessings that you have given to us. We are so grateful for the many ways that you give us what we need most. As we offer our gifts to you, we give back to you from the abundant gifts that you have given to us. May our gifts be a small reflection of our love for you and your church. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Amen. The scripture reading today is taken from Isaiah chapter 43, verses 18 and 19. Forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. Are you listening, Cheryl? See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. Thus ends the reading of this word.
Everyone, as we start our message today, I did want to give a little shout out to Jill. I don't know if you noticed, but Jill does a lot of things, big and small, that you may not notice. One of the things that I always appreciate is on the bulletins she sends out, the header always matches whatever theme we have. So our theme today was Tomorrowland. And so she chose a header that matched that theme. And she always does a great job of doing that. So I always appreciate that. The land that time forgot, that's what they really should be calling Tomorrowland. because it stopped being about tomorrow a long time ago. Now, take, for instance, Utopia. I love Utopia, and when I was a kid, it was one of my very favorite rides. I always wanted my parents to take me there whenever we went to the park. But even back then, it seemed kind of odd that it was in Tomorrowland. Now, when Disneyland opened back in 1955, Utopia was cutting-edge stuff. People didn't drive on multi-lane highways across the country. The interstate highway system had not been invented yet, believe it or not. And so people didn't drive on these highways that stretched all the way across the country. The idea that there would be this highway system that would link the country together was really appropriate then to put in Tomorrowland. But today it doesn't really make any sense. In fact, most of the rides in Tomorrowland don't make sense. The monorail is not something of tomorrow, but something of yesterday. Lots of places have monorail systems or something similar, like BART in San Francisco or MARTA in Atlanta. There are just tons of examples all over the country of monorail systems. Submersible vehicles are not just for military use anymore. People have personal submersibles. Say that three times. That's pretty hard. And Orbitron, which anchors the front of Tomorrowland, is just a preview of SpaceX when it becomes more common. Over a long period of time, Tomorrowland has become obsolete. And while they have added new things like Star Tours, they've also let lots of stuff become outdated or even disappear. People Mover lies empty. You can still see the track even today, about 25 years after they closed it down. Magic Eye Theater, which used to show cutting edge, innovative 3D movies, now is just a showcase for whatever Disney feels like putting in there. And Utopia, they're still driving cars from 1955. The problem is, like I said, Tomorrowland stopped being about tomorrow. I mean, it's still fun. But when Walt passed, they didn't stay true to his vision of what Tomorrowland is supposed to be like. He had always envisioned that Tomorrowland would stand the cutting edge of innovation to give people a glimpse into the future. But they haven't stuck to that, which is why we have gas-powered cars in the Utopia instead of solar-powered or electric or self-driving on Utopia track. Although I gotta tell you, a self-driving car as an attraction would be not all that fun for a kid. But enough people keep riding it that they don't feel the need to invest in changing it. They spent lots of money refurbishing it, but very little to reimagine what it could be. And that's because it's doing good enough. But good enough is often short-sighted. When we wait for the need to arise before we change anything, often we set ourselves up for failure. When we let good enough be the bar, we lose sight of the opportunities that could be. So someone else will come along and will do it better and be five steps ahead of the game. Like the original vision for Tomorrowland, we need to constantly strive toward a better future to better prepare for what comes ahead. If you've got a Bible or a Bible app on your phone, I want to really encourage you to follow along. I am going to read it out loud, but I always think it's great when you are able to read it from your own Bible. Something about it sticks more to you, whether that's the electronic version or whether that's a digital version or a physical version. I want to encourage you to read along with us. And if you don't have a Bible, let me know. I would be happy to get a Bible for you. Seriously, I think it's that important. So it's important for us also to be future-oriented. to keep looking forward helps keep us focused on opportunities that are coming up and what possibly could be. It drives innovation and creativity. I know I've told you before the story about Walt and the Christmas parade at Disneyland. The tradition for the Christmas parade started the first year Disneyland opened, and opened to rave reviews. It hit the million visitor mark much faster than Walt or anyone had anticipated. And Walt said, let's do a Christmas parade. And they were like, are you crazy? It's going to cost thousands of dollars. We don't really have a lot of money for that right now. You know, we just opened a brand new park. Why bother? They said, this is an incredibly popular place. You're making a ton of money. Why do you even bother doing a parade and spending more money? And Walt said, that's the point, though. He said, we should do the parade precisely because no one is expecting it. Our goal at Disneyland is to always give people more than they expect. As long as we keep surprising them, they'll keep coming back. But if they ever stop coming, it'll cost us 10 times as much to get them to come back. Give people more than they expect. Give people more than they expect. Don't just focus on what's needed now, but plan ahead for the future. Don't settle for being good enough. Figure out how to do it better. And even when it's going good, maybe especially when it's going good, find ways to make a better future. Hear now the word of the Lord. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. By faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who are heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God. By faith, even Sarah, who is past childbearing age, was enabled to bear children because she considered as numerous as the stars in the sky, him faithful who made the promise. And so from this one man, and for all that he did, came descendants as numerous as stars in the sky and as countless as sand on the seashores. All these people were still living by faith when they died. They did not receive the things promised. They only saw them and welcomed them from a distance. And they admitted that they were aliens and strangers on earth. People who say such things show that they are looking for a country of their own. If they had been thinking of the country they had left, they would have had the opportunity to return. Instead, they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. Word of God for the people of God. The people said, thanks be to God. They were longing for a better country. I love this passage in particular. I really love, because I feel like it's written in some of the most beautiful kind of vision prose. These forefathers of faith trusted in the vision that God had presented to them. And even though they couldn't see it, they were working for a tomorrow that'd be better than anything they had today. They're working for a brighter future. The reading that God gives to us says, they only saw them and welcomed them from a distance. The things God promised to the people of Israel, and by extension to all of us, wasn't something they could tangibly touch or experience, but they honored God with their efforts, even though they didn't know how it all worked out. They took chances, they risked things, just all in the hope for a better future. God is future-oriented. God is future oriented. Think about it. It was the same in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. In the Old Testament, God promised Abraham that his people would spread throughout the earth, that they would be as numerous as the stars in the sky. And even though Abraham never saw that to completion, today, billions of people are followers of Christ because of his efforts so long ago. God promised Moses that his people would see the promised land. And even though Moses himself never got to venture into it, he still led the people as if they were, and then they did. Jesus promised us the Holy Spirit. There would come a time when he wasn't going to be around, and said God would not abandon us, and that the Spirit would come and fill us and be with us. A promise is still true today. God is always looking ahead to the future while still being rooted in the present. Jesus trained up the disciples knowing that he wasn't going to be there. I mean, it would have been so easy for him to do all these miracles all by himself and gain all the glory and accolades, and maybe be easier for people to accept that he really was the Messiah. But instead, he invited people to join in on that work because he knew one day he wouldn't be there. So he told the disciples, you go and feed them. And as they did, this miracle occurred. Jesus was constantly working toward a future that he wouldn't physically see. Now, as a parent, that makes a lot of sense. You know, for me, I want to build a strong foundation to support Emma for her whole life. You know, I want to give her the best possible education because there's going to be a time when I won't be here. And I want her to have as many opportunities as possible to fulfill the dreams that God puts in her heart. I want her to know that even when I'm not around, that I'm still there looking out for her and that I still love her. I want her to be grounded in faith because I want her to know the love of God. Because when times get rough, and they will get rough, that she knows that God will be there for her. Now, I tried to teach her all these things and practical things too, and I don't always get it right. But I hope that I'm helping build a strong foundation for her future. And that even though I plan to be here for a really long time, and we'll hopefully see a lot of this come to fruition in my lifetime, that I am constantly preparing for what will lie ahead. That the things we do today will help to build a brighter tomorrow. And that's why it's important to keep striving to make things better. That even though things are going well, that we should never feel like we should rest on our laurels. Human beings love the path of least resistance, so it's tempting to stop when things are the way we like it. After all, we've seen what happens when people mess up a good thing, right? I don't know how many of you remember New Coke. I love that example because I lived through New Coke. New Coke was a disaster. Sometimes that's what happens in our efforts. Sometimes they become disasters. And that fear of failure prevents us from doing amazing things. It's because we tend to look at failure as a waste instead of an opportunity. But failure is the greatest teacher there is. It's only when we refuse to learn from the past that we truly fail. But when we succeed, it can make an impact that lasts for generations. The reason Disneyland can survive, even though Tomorrowland is outdated, is because in so many other ways, they're constantly looking into the future. They spent billions, literally billions, to remodel Cars Land and California Adventure because it wasn't working. Star Wars Galaxy's Edge, they could have just left well enough alone. They already had record crowds of people. But they spent billions to make this and had even more excitement about what was coming. By the way, our church was a risk. 90 plus years ago, the Methodist Church decided to invest in a bunch of Japanese immigrants. Japanese immigrants who didn't have experience with Jesus Christ. Who didn't have a lot of money. I mean, these were immigrants. They were coming from, they're seeking a better life for themselves, for their families. And the Methodist Church said, this is a group of people who need Jesus Christ. They didn't care that they didn't have a lot of money or wouldn't be able to afford their own churches for a long time. They invested in the people and in the future of what could be. And because they did, 90 years later, we're still here today. That's why it's important to take the kind of risks that lead us toward a brighter future, because we can't always see the possibilities that will come from it. But taking those chances sometimes helps us in ways that we can't even imagine ourselves. There are also consequences to the flip side of all of this. When we stop becoming oriented to the future, we instead become oriented to the finish line instead. When we stop being oriented to the future, we become oriented to the finish line instead. We go into survival mode. We worry more about how long we can last rather than what kind of impact we can make. We're trying to extend the time that we have left instead of investing time with what we have to create a better future. But all that does is delay the inevitable then. It's like a sinking boat. If we only concentrate on bailing out the water without plugging the hole, sure, we'll stop from sinking for a while, but eventually the forces of nature will rip the hole bigger, the water will come in faster, and it'll overwhelm us. But if we let in a little bit of water while we're fixing the boat, we can keep going for untold distances and into the future. This pandemic has given us opportunity to fix the boat. So many churches across the nation were stuck in the 20th century and suddenly got vaulted into the 21st. Online worship, social media, digital church were new to so many people, including a lot of us. And even though every indication said that this is where we were headed, people were really reticent to go there until the pandemic just forced us forward. But will we take this momentum and keep going? Or will we revert to the way we've always done things? We take this chance to try something different. Or will we play it safe and go back to what we always have known? Looking around at some of the new faces that have joined us since the pandemic started, going backward hardly seems to be an option. But are we ready for a new future? Jesus was a futurist. Disney was a futurist. Martin Luther King Jr. was a futurist. Most of the great leaders and innovators of our nation and our world have been futurists. They're always looking ahead to what was possible and working toward that. How can our church do anything different? This is one of my favorite quotes, and you know it because I've just used it like a couple of weeks ago. But Robert Kennedy once said, "Some people see things as they are and say, why? I dream things that never were and say, why not?" What is your why not? What's something that you've held back from daring to dream? What's something that you would like to accomplish but haven't done so? And then ask yourself, why not? Utopia is great, but it'll never be more than what it is unless someone does a work to make it better. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, thank you for listening, everyone. Naomi always does such an amazing job of giving thanks. I'm not going to steal that thunder. I'm going to let her do it. But I want to echo whatever Naomi says, but also give thanks to her and to Jill, who really are the worship team that helps put all this together. And I know I rely on both of them to help make worship what it is. Special thanks also to Cheryl. Hello, Cheryl. I can see you on my screen. For stepping in today and for everyone who helps out. But I'm going to let Naomi give the rest of our thanks and also share what we're about to hear. Naomi.
Thank you, Reverend Craig. Well, we also want to thank our pianist today. It's kind of like when we're at, you know, in-person church, we usually just have one pianist, and today it's Irene. And I want to thank her for this, you know, we never quite know how the music is going to fit in, but it just seems like every week it comes together and just tells the story and the theme of our Sunday so beautifully. So I want to thank Irene for those beautiful choices for prelude and offertory. And of course, thanks Stephanie Suzuki for that, you know, just rousing and blessing filled song, Your Grace is Enough. And also thank TAC for helping us with technical lyric videos. And in closing, we have a song that I think, I was thinking about, you know, how am I going to talk about this song? I mean, I think it sort of speaks for itself. This is Tomorrow from Annie. And I think it's the perfect song to take as a song in your heart for the beginning of this week and throughout the week. And I think the message is uplifting, helps us think about the blessings that are coming to us each day and tomorrow. And so we have this beautiful rendition from our very own Naomi Mascarinas. So this is Tomorrow from Annie. Day that's
Yay, that was wonderful. Thank you to Naomi and Jill and Cheryl and Irene and everyone who makes worship possible. Yeah, I love that song. It's kind of been my anthem for the past 4 years. So let's go into tomorrow and knowing that there's always is one, and to prepare for that day that we might share the love of Christ with the world that needs it. We just give up thanks to God for giving us a chance to be together and to share and worship. But at the same time, for us to reimagine what it'll be like to reach that next generation, that they might know Christ and have Christ deep in their hearts. We pray for this in the name of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. It is wonderful, as always, to have been able to worship with you all. I hope that you will stay around for a few minutes and say hi to everyone.